and welcome to UHP TV. In this series, we're talking about the use of robotics in surgery, and I'm here live in Theatre One, one of our 36 theatres here at the Trust. The Trust is leading the way in the Southwest in the use of robotics in certain specialities, and I've been joined here today by Sebastian, who is the consultant colorectal surgeon, to talk about the use of robotics in colorectal surgery. Hello, Sebastian. So can you talk me through the journey of the use of robotics in colorectal surgery so far?
So the first everything started in 2015 when our urology colleagues bought the robot for the Trust. We as a colorectal, we start introducing ourselves in 2016, but eventually we start in 2020 with the first three cases. And then since that, we continue since that. So far we've done 60 cases and we operate every week on Friday, and we mainly use the robot for rectal surgery, when this benefit for the patient is the biggest.
And what kind of factors do you need to consider when understanding whether a patient can have robotic-assisted surgery or general laparoscopic surgery?
So obviously, robotic surgery, we now dedicate to more complex cases, and by that we understand the low rectal cancer. Obviously, in the male pelvis, when it's a narrow pelvis, when it's difficult to get access to with instruments, we use robot as a clear benefit for the patient. Obviously, robot have a three-dimensional view, they have a multiple dimension movement of the arms, and we can access the operative fields in a much better way, and we have a better and stable platform to do the operation.
So you talked a bit about the benefits of doing the surgery with a robotic assisted way then. What are the benefits for the patients and also for the surgeons carrying it out?
So the best benefits for the patient is, first of all, the operative trauma is way less than any other operation. We use diathermy, we don't use any other energy device. And then thanks to robot, to the stable platform, traction, and then great visualization, we cut in the right planes. So the patient have a less blood loss. The pain, postoperative pain, is way less for the patient as well. They're able to mobilize faster and come back to the normal activities, to the normal baseline very fast. We know from our data that we cut the length of stay for hospital for our patient, comparing to laparoscopic for rectal surgery, by 2 days. So on average, our patient go home day 3-4, the 3-5, and the laparoscopic 5-7. So that saves a huge amount of time for patients to spend in hospital when they can recover at home. Obviously, that's great for hospital because we can treat more patients. From surgical perspective, obviously, we after docking the robot, we scrub out and scrub off, and we sit in the console. So this as operation takes usually 3, 4, or 5 hours. You sit on a comfortable place, you're not tired, you don't have to retract it physically, the robot do that for you, you have amazing view, and you can do better operation for the patient. And that's also better operation in the way when we see everything, it transforms to better oncological outcome.
And how many patients can we currently treat in this way?
So since we started, we treat 60 patients so far. We operate every week, and we, in fairness, is great news today because it just bought the new robot and actually arrived to hospital today. And we are hoping to expand our service, and we probably will be able to treat double this number, and hopefully with the couple years, triple. So most of our patients will be offered robotic surgery in the near future.
Wonderful. That sounds truly fantastic. So we actually do have a clip of the robot in action. So Seb, can you talk me through what's happening in this?
Of course. So at the moment we are pulling out the rectum from the pelvis, and now we're opening the peritoneum to get access to the main vessel, which provide the blood supply to the rectum. So we continue towards the vessel, and that you can see the vessel now. It's called inferior mesenteric artery, and we make creating the window to apply the clips and cut it.
So presumably operating in this way, kind of separate from the patient, feels a bit different to how you originally trained.
It is. Obviously, I've been training the robot as well. It takes a little bit of time to get used to, but it's definitely very nice ways to operate a patient. And the way when you're not physically tired when you do that. And I, sitting on the console, I have stereotactic vision, so I can see the perception. So that's just something which we cannot see on a laparoscopic surgery. Now we discontinue the colon from the lateral attachments. And that will finish mobilization of left colon. We didn't see mobilization of the splenic flexure, but please trust me, I did it. Now we're opening the peritoneum down towards the pelvis to be able to fully retrieve the rectum before we move to the mesorectal space.
What are you kind of feeling and what are you thinking when a process like this is going on?
Obviously, you focus on the operation. You make sure that you're in the right planes and you're not causing any bleeding. And you want to get preserve all the major structure like nerves, which will impact the patient quality of life. So we mainly focus on that. And also, I got my assistant in the bed how to perform retraction for me on my on the colon, as we still use assistant to retract, you know, use the retraction. Now we're mobilizing very low towards the anus. When the TME plane is mobilized, we're going towards the intersphincteric space slowly. This is rectum from the bottom. So the rectum is on the top, and we're dissecting the attachment on the bottom. Now we're moving towards the front, and opening the space between the rectum and prostate. You will very soon see the seminal vesicles. To allow that dissection, we suspend a little bit peritoneum on the bladder to give us enough traction to be able to see seminal vesicle quite clearly.
And as you said before, a benefit to using robotics in a treatment like this is that you can get into difficult tight spaces. Is that something that's going on here?
Exactly. So if you imagine this is a male pelvis, quite narrow, with bulky mesorectum, which is a fat around the rectum, and it's very difficult to get to very low with a laparoscopic instrument, which is straight. The articulation of robotic instruments, you see, allow us to cut in a multiple dimension and get to the right plane. Now we're going towards on the side, and we soon should see the seminal vesicles, which will be in the front. We get full mobilization, and now we use the stapler to dissect the rectum on the junction between the rectum and anus. So what we leave behind is only the muscle and then 1 centimeter above them to perform anastomosis. We use usually 2 shots to do it. And as you see, the rectum with very good mesorectum is now retrieved back.
Thank you so much for that descriptive detail there, Seb. So we've been joined by a patient who's had a similar procedure only a few months ago. This is Clive, who's going to be talking us through his journey. So hi, Clive. Can you tell us a bit about how you came to have your diagnosis?
Well, basically, I was get the symptoms I was getting was constipation, and then I was forcing myself to go to the loo, and then I was seeing clots of blood. So then I contacted my GP right away, and she told me she was going to contact the Colorectal clinic, and I'd be hearing from them, and that happened within a couple of days. And by the end of the week, I was in here having a colonoscopy. It was all very quick. So I had the colonoscopy, and from that time, I was told right away that I had the cancer. So they brought my wife in and sat her down. So she was a little bit concerned, but really, I knew there was something wrong, and I just had to accept it and put my hands into the professionals to sort it out. And so they offered me a lot of backup, but I really didn't need it. It all happened so quick. I was in within a couple of weeks for scans, and then I came in and saw a consultant who explained, he had a booklet which explained what my cancer was, and that the piece that was going to be removed. And then from there, I went and had a CT scan, and then I came and met Dr. Smolarek. And that was the time my mind was really put at ease, because a couple of days before, I had to go and see a stoner nurse in case I needed to have a bag. And I had these 2 marks on my tummy. And Seb said to me straight away, "What's that?" I said, "Well, that's for this little stoner bag." He said, "You're not having none of that," he said. And my mood just lifted straight away. And he explained the operation. And I literally came in the following day. I met him at the entrance to the operating theatre. Came in. We did the consent form. And then Seb went off to get it scrubbed up. I went in to get myself ready. And the next thing I knew, I was in with the anaesthetist. And they put a mask over my face, and that's the last thing I knew. The day after the operation, I was straight out and into the chair, sat up. And then I was walking around the following day. And then within 4 days, I came in on the Friday, I went on one the Tuesday morning. It was that quick. And of course, it felt a bit strange at first, and my mobility was a little bit slow, but I recovered within a few weeks.
That is fantastic to hear.
Oh, it's incredible. I can't tell you.
So it sounds like you went on quite a journey. Can you describe the kind of emotions and what you were feeling throughout that process?
My emotions were, I really didn't have emotions because my whole family has suffered with cancer. I lost my mum when I was 18 with a tumour on the brain. I got four sisters and all of them had cancer. Also, my son has had testicular cancer. So I thought I was the odd one out. So when I heard the news, I thought, well, that's it. I can now get on with my life because you're in the hands of these wonderful people here. And it was explained to me in great detail about this robotic machine and what it does. And I'm the proof of the pudding. I had five or six holes in my tummy. I haven't been opened up. And they've done everything inside. And the healing procedure is very quick.
So when you first got your diagnosis, how did you kind of, what prompted you to think maybe I've got bowel cancer?
It wasn't until I started seeing the blood that I thought, well, it must be because I saw the advert on the television that told you that if you see blood, to contact your GP. And literally, from phoning the doctor, I was diagnosed in September and I had the operation in the 26th of November.
What would you say to somebody who might be on a waiting list waiting for bowel cancer surgery if they were offered robotic surgery?
Take it. The thing is, the doctor explained then, but the recovery time is so quick. Everything was done so quick and so efficient. And then I was back in again in January just to be confirmed that everything went well.
And you've got the all clear now?
I've had the all clear, yes.
That is fantastic. Mm-hmm. Well, thank you so much for talking to us today.
Yes, sure.
So we did catch up with our colorectal consultant and bowel specialist, Mark Coleman, who's going to talk us through some preventative measures that people can take.
So I'm Mark Coleman. I'm a consultant colorectal surgeon or bowel surgeon at University Hospitals Plymouth, and I'm also chairman of Bowel Cancer West, which is a regional charity.
Wonderful. So we're talking today about the use of robotics in our colorectal surgery. As our bowel cancer specialist, could you please give us a bit of information about preventative measures people can take to avoid the risk of bowel cancer?
Thank you. So yeah, bowel cancer is unfortunately quite a common condition in our community, particularly affecting in most cases older people, but also can affect people of any adult age. It is a condition that is more common in developed countries like the United Kingdom. And it is associated with, particularly with poor diet, lack of exercise and being overweight. So it's very important to focus on these things throughout one's life.
Okay, and what kind of patients do we generally see in colorectal?
Okay, so bowel cancer is seen equally in men and women. As I say, most of them are elderly. And we see patients that are coming who are concerned about symptoms like having blood in their poo, if I can use that word, and just change of their normal bowel habit or any other concerns like abdominal pains or weight loss and anything else related to the bowels. Very happy to see them. And there's a very good 2-week wait pathway between primary care or your general practitioner and the hospital to make sure that patients are seen and investigated in a timely way.
And what would a piece of advice you could give someone who's just been diagnosed, and what kind of things would you suggest they do as they progress with their treatment?
So it's important to know that early recognition of symptoms, early investigation, early treatment is really important. And the message I want to give to patients who are worried about this or may have just been diagnosed is in many cases it's a curable condition with the right treatment. And so they can get back to their normal lives. Many people also fear and worry about having to have a bag on their tummy, otherwise known as a stoma. And actually most of our patients never end up in that situation at all. So really get to your doctor early, get seen, get investigated, get treated as soon as possible.
Some great advice there, Mark. I've been joined again with Seb and Clive to talk about some questions we've received from national networks, support groups, and patients. So, we've got a question here, perhaps for you, Seb, from Bowel Cancer UK, who's asking, who specifically performs the operation? And this comes off a survey where they carried out that says perhaps there's a misconception that the robot was pre-programmed to perform the operation themselves.
No, we're not there yet, probably next 20 years, but at the moment surgeons perform operation, just stay away from the patient on the console and use joystick and a robot mimic, you know, your movements are transferred to the robotic arms in the patient.
And we've got a good one here for yourself, Clive. Did you experience any side effects from your robotic-assisted surgery?
Well, the only thing that happened was after you've had the surgery, you are tender and you know that things are starting to be placed again. You know that something's missing. That's the first thing that you feel. And the other thing was, if you had to do any heavy breathing or sneezing, you could feel that come down through your tummy. But, you know, you've got to expect something after having such surgery. And it didn't last long, and I can honestly say within 3 to 4 weeks, that went. And I was back to normal.
Brilliant to hear.
You know, so I was exercising as I did before and getting back to my normal life.
Wonderful. So, Seb, can you explain what kind of things patients can expect in the time after surgery?
Well, they also have oral pain relief, so they might get a little bit of discomfort, which can manage very well. If everything according to the plan, then day one, they can drink, they can get some light diet. Day two, they come back to normal kind of diet, they mobilize. We remove catheter day one, we remove, if any drain left, just remove the day one. And usually day three, day four, patients are expected to go home. Obviously, as any operation, there are deviations from the plan. And then we kind of, that's why we keep the patient in hospital for a couple of days, not let them go home day one. But then, you know, the biggest fear, like with everything in colorectal surgery, is obviously an anastomotic leak. So we are keeping a very close eye on patient.
Thank you. And thank you for Bowel Cancer UK for those questions. So we've got one in here from David who asks, who can have robot-assisted surgery and why isn't it suitable for everyone? So Seb?
So almost everybody can have robotic surgery. For colorectal perspective, who is not suitable is all of people who have quite advanced cancer and they need multivisceral resection. So for example, bladder and prostate, they probably not benefit from from robotic surgery. That operation will take longer. It needs sometimes reconstruction of pelvic floor, and that's where robot is not really, you know, the patient won't get the benefits from it. On the other side, almost everybody can have operation.
And finally, we've got one here on a similar theme. An anonymous person has asked if they are at a disadvantage if they can't have robotic-assisted surgery.
You know, the robot is just a tool. So the most important is operator. If someone is very good and still, you know, slick with laparoscopic surgery, there's not many disadvantage for the patient. Obviously, robot and some like rectal surgery, the advantage of robot, it's much better. But if you're not able to have it, you know, it's better to have laparoscopic surgery than no surgery or open. But it's not, you know, for like right hemicolectomies, there's not many advantage to not doing robotic operation.
Okay. So that's all the questions we've got for today. So I'd just like to say thank you for tuning in to UHP TV. Thank you very much to Clive and Seb for talking to us and Mark for talking to us previously. If you'd like to know any more about surgeries and the use of robotics and surgery here at UHP, tune into the next one of our series. Thank you for watching.